Praise the name of the Lord, everybody.
Amen.
Good evening, everybody.
Amen.
Come on now, praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Amen.
I will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Please stand with me while I pray. Let us pray together. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy, Lord. We invite you and we welcome you into this place, Lord, to have your way, sweet Holy Spirit, God. Break the yokes up of our lives, Lord. God, meet us and come into the midst of your people. Have your way in the name of Jesus. We bind everything that's not like you, Lord. We cast our cares upon you tonight, Lord. Come in the midst of your people. Break yokes and chains in our lives, God. God, you are mighty and omnipotent, God. We thank you and we praise your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. There'll be a scripture reading.
Hallelujah.
Good evening.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
I just wanted to encourage you all to trust and believe God. We can trust God and his word. We can move any mountain, any situation in our life, no matter what it is, if it's in our body, if it's concerning the salvation of a loved one, if it's finances. We must believe God's word and trust him concerning any situation. It doesn't matter what it looks like. When you are trusting and believing God, God can turn any situation around. Psalms 89:3-4. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the things that come out of my lips. 1 Corinthians 2:5, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for those who love the Lord, who are called according to his purpose. And I just kind of want to just talk about a major trial that's happened in my life. And it was years ago. It was my dad. He was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. This was in 2009. And my dad, his whole life, I just seen this is something that we believe and trust God for.
Right.
And this is something that, you know, I looked up to my mother, and she believed and trusted in God. I didn't really understand it, but she used to hold on to certain scriptures, especially. Acts 16:31, where it says, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. And my dad, he was a good man, but he was really caught up in the things of this world. And he was always one to push things later on, say, I got it later. But God had to slow him down, almost him to put all, but I seen a miracle. Because I know my dad.
Amen.
And that whole time when he was sick, something that the devil intended for bad, and the hope to get him and lock him in and put him in fear, rejection. Because I'm a nurse, I see people sick all the time, and it's either they just mad and angry and tense, or it's almost like something's carrying them through with peace, the peace of God.
Amen.
And I can just say that the last 6 months of my dad's life, he had the peace of God in him.
Amen.
And I knew that it was Jesus, because it was the strength in him, the faith in him. It was just so strong, and I was like, it was a whole new person.
Amen.
So I just thank God for that, and I know it came from trusting and believing God. It doesn't matter what the situation is, even in something like that. And sometimes God may not do it the way we want him to do it, but he does it. He gonna always come through,
always.
Yes. So what if we did not put our trust in God in that situation? So I just thank, we just thank God just for who he is.
Yes.
Because he is our everything.
Amen.
For the 1 Thessalonians 5:16-19. Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all situations. This is the will of God in your life.
Yes.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
Come on, pull down from your belly and give Him a praise. Jesus. We want to make sure that everyone gets a program tonight so that we can follow what's written in the program. Does everyone have a program tonight? Amen. So we want to just flow in the Holy Ghost. It's not even my turn. So, amen. Just give the Lord a praise right now. He's worthy.
Amen. Somebody give the Lord some praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Did you come to worship the Lord?
When storms are raging, He's my shelter, He's my shelter.
more time to say, inherit my praise. That's it, somebody just talk to him and say, inherit my praise.
What a wonder you are, what a wonder. Yeah.
you, but you gave it. And tonight we celebrate. Amen. We just want you to go back in history with us. Talk about the seven last words of Jesus prior to his death, burial. And so happy for the resurrection. Amen. We want to talk about the things he said that still ring significant in our lives that we will allow it to. Amen. That still is important even today. I believe they said that was over 2,000 years ago. But how many know it's just like fresh, like a cold mass of water in a hot desert. It's just like it just happened. And it refreshes and restores our soul. Amen. So we're going to ask that the speakers will follow how it is written in our bulletins. And we just want to go through a flow like that. So let's say amen as the first person comes.
Hi, my name is Chanel Johnson. I'm a member of Vineyard Baptist Christian Center. My pastor is Bishop Greg Davis Sr. and First Lady Sabine Davis. My life verse is Mark 11:23. If you say unto the mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and thou doubt in your heart but believe those things whichever you have said, it shall come to pass. We are just like our Father. We can speak to things just as he does, and things have to happen. The fivefold ministry group that I operate in, the strongest, is of a prophet, pastor, teacher. My spiritual gifts that I operate in, the strongest, is showing mercy and faith. The fruit of the Spirit that I operate in most is peace. Let us bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you, Lord. We just thank you for this moment, Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus. We ask, Lord Jesus, that you open our ears, Heavenly Father. Open our minds, open our hearts, Heavenly Father. Help us to receive this word, Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus. Let your will be done, Lord Jesus. And speak through me, Heavenly Father, as you want your people to hear. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now the topic that I will be speaking on is based off of Luke 23:34. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Now, when they crucified Jesus, they stripped him, put thorns on his skull, spit on him. He was naked. They took his clothes. They departed it. And that's what he said. He said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And he was sinless. No sin was found in him. So if he can do that, how much more can we do? And we have sin in us. And we are instructed to forgive. Colossians 3:23 says, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. In Luke 6:27, but I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you, and pray for those who spitefully use you. Now we are instructed to forgive. And we cannot let our feelings come in a way of forgiving. It's not about how we feel, we are instructed to. And God knows everything that goes on. When he says that, he's saying it to everyone. Not just me, not just you, but everyone in the whole world. So he knows. So, and, you know, he say, be prepared to forgive, for offenses will come. So we know offenses will come, because in Luke 17:1-4, then he said to his disciples, it is impossible that no offense should come, but woe to him through whom they do come. It is impossible that no offense should come, but woe to them through whom they do come. It would be better for him if a milestone were hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea than that he should offend one of these little ones. Take heed to yourself. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you 7 times in a day, and 7 times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. So in difficult times, we must forgive. And there are some situations that are harder to forgive. And Jesus addresses this. In Luke 17:4, if he trespasses against thee 7 times in a day, and 7 times in a day turn again unto thee, saying, I repent, thou shalt forgive him. Because that sounded so hard to do, the apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. So we can have faith. Because they asked to increase our faith. But this is the reply that Jesus said. He said, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you might say unto the sycamore tree, be thou plucked up by the root, and be thou planted to the sea, and it shall obey you. So we have the faith. We have it. We can. We got to use God's word. We can ask God, say, help us to forgive. We can ask God for everything else, for finances and other things. So we can ask him, help us to forgive. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Help me, Lord. Help me in my weaknesses. Help me in my weaknesses, for you are my strength. Your strength is made perfect in my weaknesses. That's what we need to do with them hard situations.
So,
what must we do in order to be forgiven? We must forgive others. That is a requirement. For us to be forgiven, we must forgive others. And we must confess our sin. That's why we're supposed to have a constant communication with God. Constantly asking for forgiveness, constantly forgiving, keeping this channel open, and keeping our channel with our neighbor open. So when you have a hard time and you're faced with that mountain of unforgiveness, just think about what Jesus did. If he can do it, and he had no sin in him, then we can too. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I just thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord, I just ask, Lord, that you plant this word, Heavenly Father, in your people, Heavenly Father, they can keep this. They can let this come to their remembrance. And I just thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. I flow in the fivefold ministry gifts of evangelist. It's my strongest. Then prophet, pastor, teacher. My spiritual gifts are word of knowledge, faith, word of wisdom, and teaching. I operate strongest in the fruit of the spirit of meekness, temperance, joy, and long suffering. Father God, thank you for allowing us to worship together tonight, to do these 7 words.
Yes, Lord.
Of what our Lord Jesus said on the cross. Be with each of us, and help us to speak your words with clarity for the audience to hear and comprehend what you want them to hear and understand. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. I want you to just, Pastor Deborah gave us a vivid picture of Jesus on the cross. And I just want you to kind of think a little bit about him in the middle here. He has two sinners on each side of him. Now, there's one sinner that's mocking him and say that you're who you say you are. Get down. I mean, you ask your father to help you get down. And then there's this other sinner. He's a thief. And he said, listen, he's praying for you. We have sinned and we deserve to die. He has done nothing to deserve this. So this is the verse that I have, but I'm going to say the thief's verse. He says, in Luke 23:42, he says, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Now, Jesus ignored. He ignored his own suffering. He ignored his thirst, the blood, the dirtiness of his body, the pain that he felt in his hands and his feet. But he responds to this thief with love and mercy in his second word. He said, truly, I say to you today, you will be with me in paradise. And that comes from Luke 23:43. Now Jesus' second words is about forgiveness. He directed his answer to a sinner. He directed his answer to this sinner. Now just as Chanel has said in the first words, which was found in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus showed his affinity by opening heaven to a repentant sinner. Now just think of this generosity that Jesus is showing this sinner. And all the man asked him was to be remembered. Now, this expression offers us hope for salvation. For we turn our hearts and prayers to him and we accept his forgiveness. And we will also be with Jesus at the end of our lives. Jesus died bringing truth of eternal life to a man that was damned, a damned soul. Now, when I was studying these words, and the word paradise, I didn't quite understand what that was, but I know that it's a synonym for heaven. It's a synonym for heaven. And I found some things about heaven. And last night at my church, we did Passover Seder, and at the end, it said that we'll see you in Jerusalem. But I want to tell you about what most people call heaven is actually an eternal city. Yes. And the Bible calls it the New Jerusalem. Yes. It will be spectacular. Yes. Now, it's going to be a river. It's going to be clear as crystal. Yes. And it will flow from the throne of God and the Lamb, which is Jesus, down the middle of the city. On each side of the river, there will be a tree of life, yielding 12 kinds of fruit every month. Now the streets will be of pure gold, like transparent glass. The walls of the city will be adorned with every kind of jewel. It's going to be emeralds and onyx and amethyst and topaz, all kinds of jewels. And there will be no need for a sun or a moon. Because, and then there's not going to be any need for a temple or a church. Because the presence of the Lord is going to be the light. He's going to be my light.
Right.
Now, this sounds, this beautiful heaven sounds good, but this is what I want you to, I'm going to share this with you. Now, the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For old order of things has passed away. And he says, I'm making everything new. Now, when I got this, when she passed out and told us what words we were going to say from Jesus, and everybody picked theirs, and the second one was left. And then when I got home, I said, oh, I think I'm going to change that. But then after I got to studying about it, I said, no, that's what my track is about. And it is. That's what my track is about. And I'd like to give these out. I like to give the tracks out. I like to give them out to everybody. Just when I say everybody. But what I want them to do is to declare it out loud. Now, I can give it to them and they can take it home and maybe put it on their coffee table, put it in their Bible. But I'm amazed at the people that say it out loud. Right there, if I'm in Walgreens or wherever I am, they would just read it. I say, ooh, what happened there? I didn't really know they would do that, but they do it. And I want, you may have said it before, which is okay, but I want you to declare this sinner's prayer out loud with me. You repeat after me. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I come into your presence. Please forgive me of all my sins. Cleanse me. And remove the curse off me. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. And be my Lord and Savior. I'm now saved. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Father, for hearing my prayer.
Thank you for forgiving me of all my sins.
Thank you for coming into my life.
Thank you for loving me.
Thank you for your word.
I will live by the Bible.
I rejoice in your salvation.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
My name is Minister Tanisha Lowe, and I am a partner with my church, Walk of Faith. My pastors are Pastor Marcus and Angela Howard. My life scripture verses are Proverbs 10 and 22. The blessings of the Lord make it rich, and he added no sorrow with it. And Deuteronomy 8 and 18. Thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for
For it is he that giveth thee the power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he saith unto thy fathers, as it is this day. I flow in the fivefold ministry gift of prophet, pastor, and teacher. My ministry gifts are prophecy, word of wisdom, leadership, ministry of health, showing mercy, and the spirit of discernment. I operate the strongest in the fruit of love, kindness, gentleness, and peace. Today, I will be ministering on Jesus' last seven words that is found in the Gospel of John 19, 26, and 27. Let us pray. Father God, I come to you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, thanking you, Lord, for this day and this opportunity, Lord, that you have given me, Father God, to stand before your people, Father God, and to exalt your name, Father God. I thank you, Lord, that you will move on the hearts and the minds of your people, Father God, that when they leave this place, Lord, they will be encouraged to know, Father God, that you love them, Father God, that you chose them and that you called them, Father God, for a time such as this, Father God. They will leave, Father God, with no confusion, Father God, but with a ready and made up mind, Father God, to love like you have loved us, Father God. Lord, we thank you, Father God, that the Spirit of God is in this house, Father God, and as I minister the word, Jesus' name. Amen. John 19, 26 and 27 reads, Jesus said to his mother, Woman, this is your son. Then he said to the disciple, This is your mother. Now this is a very interesting scripture because as we know, Jesus is at the foot of the cross. And these is his last seven words. But if we go to Matthew 12, 46 through 50, he tells them that his mother, his brother, and his sister is those that do the will of the Father. So if we are doing the will of the Father, we are considered the beloved of Jesus. And just like when Jesus left this earth, he made sure that his disciple knew to take care of his mother. And we have to remember why Jesus had to leave in the first place. It wasn't just so that we can be free, and it wasn't just so that we can be delivered from our sin and forgiven for our sin, but he also went to the cross and died for us because he tells us in John that he had to go away. He had to go away so that the Holy Spirit can come. Had he not been away, the Holy Spirit will not be here today. But because he went away, Jesus, the Holy Spirit lives in us today. He said that he would send an advocate, hallelujah, and he would guide us, he would lead us, told his disciples, take care of my mother. And that's what he was doing when he told his mother, this is your son. This is your son. I need you to take care of him the way you took care of me. But God did not make no distinction. He said, this woman. He didn't say, my mother. He said, this woman. But the scriptures tells us his mother, his sister, and his brother are those that keep the commandment of his father. Are you keeping the commandments of the father? Are you trying diligently and earnestly to be about your father's business? And if you're not, it's not too late to start again. God is not just a God of a second chance, but he is a God of another and another and another chance. Hallelujah. There is nothing that we can do that will cause him to look down on us, that will cause him to turn his back on us. He turned his back on sin, and he hates sin, but he loves the sinner. And that's why he has given you and I a commandment to go and preach and teach the word of God so that others may come to know him, so that others may believe on his word and they should be saved too. The book of John also tells us, forgive me if you don't mind, let me turn to it so I get it right. Hallelujah. How many of you love the Lord today? Yes, he is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah, Jesus. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him. For he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. And that is exactly what he did when he left his mother and the disciples. He left them hand in hand. Arm sharpens arm. We need to be accountable to one another. We need to connect with somebody in the faith that's going to share the word of God, that's going to minister and demonstrate the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Father God, we just thank you, Father God, that your word went forth on tonight, Father God, that someone is encouraged, Father God, to love more like you, Father God, that someone is encouraged, Father God, to walk in a spirit of forgiveness, Father God. Lord, I ask that anything that is in us that's not like you, Father God, that you deliver, that you heal, and that you set us free. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord. My name is Karen Sims. I am a member of the Church of Jesus, and my leader is Jesus Christ. My life verse that I live by is Philippians 4 and 13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The fivefold calling that I operate in is the prophetic, evangelistic, and exhortation ministry. The fruit of the Spirit that I operate in is love, joy, and gentleness. My topic is, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I ask, Lord, that you have your way, God. I ask in the name of Jesus that you take me where I need to be, God. And when you're done, Father, bring me back down, Father. Humble me before your presence, Lord. Let your will be done, Lord. Let not flesh glory in your sight, but let your word be done. Use me, Lord, in the way that you see fit, God. And I thank you in the name of Jesus. My topic is, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? From Luke 27, 46, Mark 15, and 34. I looked up the definition of forsaken, because all the times when we go through trials, we think that we are forsaken. The definition was abandoned, to leave someone, especially in a time of need. Now Jesus was beaten, as it was said, 39 lashes minus one, which was the maximum amount that anyone could be beaten in that time without dying. Nails were hammered in his hands and feet, and he was also given a crown of thorns pressed in his head. He had every right to ask, why has he been forsaken? It was his journey to grace. And I think about every time when we go through something, it seems like we left and we're all alone and no help. No family, no one to come to the need. Just look like God has forgotten all about you, especially when you don't get it right then and right now. Praise the name of the Lord. And God took me back to where, even in the old of Deuteronomy, when Moses was leading the people out of the wilderness and Pharaoh was chasing after them. God sent his word then in Deuteronomy 31 and 6. He said, be strong, of good courage. Don't be afraid. The Lord your God is with you. He won't abandon you. Praise the name of the Lord. And from Moses to passing down the baton, which was switched over to Joseph, and Joseph saw all that he had and what all he had to deal with, and he became worried in his leadership. But God spoke to him in Joshua 1 and 5 and said, I will never leave you or forsake you. As I was with Moses, so shall I be with you. And for us today, no matter what we go through, no matter what it looks like, no matter how our children are not doing what they should be doing in their lives, no matter how their husband won't treat you the way that you want to be treated, when the doctor comes in and tells you he's done all that he could for you, there's no more that he can do, and you're laying on death's bed there alone by yourself. God has a word, and he's the same God as he was in the day of Moses. And Joshua, he's the same God today. And his word says in Psalms 94 and 14, this is for us. For the Lord will not reject his people. He will never leave his inheritance. That's you and me and our children. He will never forsake us. John 16 and 33, it tells us that we're going to have these trials and these tribulations, but we're not alone. And God began to say to me, now you know that I'll never forsake you. Have you thought about will you ever forsake me? When I laid up there on the cross, hung up there and died with the nails in my hands, will you forsake me in your prayer life? When they put that crown in my head and it was pressed and blood was coming down, will you forsake me in your tithes and your offering and your going to church? God said, when they pierced him in the side, he said, will you forsake me and abandon me and not acknowledge me in all your ways after I've hung, bled, and died? Praise the name of the Lord. I couldn't answer him, my God. But I don't want to forsake him because he's never forsaken me. And no matter what it looks like, even when I thought nobody loved me and cared about me, that's the same for you God does. And then he gave me this. I want you all to stand with me and just share this with me, please. Will everyone stay just for a minute? Say April 14th. Repeat after me. April 14th.
God will never leave me.
Or forsake me.
Or
abandon me.
I'm still standing.
Throw in the towel. Good, because greater is he that's in me.
Amen. We love God. We love His word tonight. Amen. We're so happy for the students that have gone forth so far. How many have enjoyed that word? Amen. Go ahead, students, and get your preach on. Amen. We are enjoying you, this ministry, Harvest Time Prayer Ministry. I think we have been going on close to about 20 years. I started about 20 years ago. And I'm giving God glory that I haven't got tired yet. Amen. The prayers of the righteous won't let me give up. Amen. But we're so thankful for this ministry, we believe, that has been founded. Amen. And been approved by God. This approval is on it. Our mission is to raise an army of worldwide intercessors. Amen. And spirit-filled, spirit-led leaders. And we're believing, God, that we are carrying out the mission that He gave us. I would like to ask all our students, former and present student, to stand. All the students present, former students. Amen. Let's give the Lord a praise for these men and women of God. The school of prayer, thank you, you may be seated, is for men and for women. God said, I look for a man to stand in the gap. Now, we know that God was not necessarily speaking of gender, but we want you to know that men are welcome in this school. We meet every Tuesday night starting at 6:30 p.m. We meet at this church in the fellowship hall, and we start out with a fantastic off-the-chain chapel service. I mean, when the Spirit of the Lord is alive. Amen. He meets us here every Tuesday at 6:30. And that's our time we call washing off the earth. Whatever bothered you that day. Whatever bothered you on the way to school. That's our time to wash it off and give God the glory. And I tell you, God comes in. The Holy Spirit takes control. And we have an awesome worship. The worship leader you heard earlier is our worship leader on Tuesday night, and every round goes higher and higher. We ask in amen that you will attach yourself to this ministry, to this school, if you're interested in becoming a student. We make our fees so that it's our payment plan is better than the layaway at Walmart. What we give you is better than what you could put in the layaway at Walmart. Amen. We endeavor to give you a pure word, a holy word. Amen. Straight from the presence of God. We believe in giving you fresh manna. Amen. Because our teachers pray and they fast and they seek the Lord, they study. Amen. To hear from God. May our teachers stand tonight. I only see one at this point. Amen. Evangelist Cheryl Cherry is one of our teachers. She's one of the teachers for the third year. Amen. And we're so happy for her. Amen. Some of our teachers could not make it tonight, but we do believe we have some awesome teachers in our school. We are a Bible college and not a Bible study. So when we say come, we do everything that a Bible college will do. Amen. Study, pray, fast. Amen. Give you a word, give you a test, give you a final exam, give you a book report. We go through the whole nine yards. Amen. And we believe, God, that by the time you complete, you'll have direction from the Lord. If you're interested, you can see Sister Cheryl. Cheryl, what's your name? Sister Pearl Dorsey. Will you stand, please? She's my administrative assistant. Let's give Sister Pearl a hand. Want any information, we are ready to enroll for next year. We'll be starting in September. So if you're interested, give her your information and we'll send you brochures and applications and everything that you will need. While I was giving you an opportunity to write out that check, you spelled thousand, T-H-O-U-S-A. Glory to God. Amen.
Praise the Lord. I want to lift your voices in this place to give Him glory. Hallelujah. Bless your name, God. Hallelujah. I come before you just as I am and lay me at your feet. I bring before you Jesus, I'm free.
Gifts are teaching, words of knowledge, words of wisdom, faith, and ministration. Love, faith, and joy are the top three fruit of the Spirit that I operate in the most. As I pray, my God, my God, my God, I thank you for this day. I thank you for everybody in attendance, Father. I thank you for the love and the support that they have come to give us on today, Father God. I thank you for this school, Father God. I thank you for my teachers. I thank you for this church home, this house in the school, Father God. I thank you for my pastor, Father God, and all the opportunities that he has given me, Father God, for such a day as this. I thank you, Father God, for all that you have done in my life and us.
others that's here today, Father God. I pray, Father God, that you open up the minds of those that are here, Father God, so that their minds will be renewed. I pray that you open up their hearts, Father God, so that it may be transformed. And I just thank you for it, Father God. In your Son Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
The title that I will be speaking on is I Thirst. And it's coming from John chapter 19, verse 28. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. Jesus' words, I thirst, remind us of Jesus' physical nature. This was only a verbal expression of his physical suffering. He was flogged, or shall I say beaten. He was crowned with thorns. He walked the way of the cross and was nailed to it. I want y'all to ponder on that for a moment. Let it marinate. Again, he was beaten. He was crowned with thorns. He walked the way of the cross and he was nailed to it. All for what? That's right, for us, humanity. Jesus the judge assumed the consequence of sin on the part of man, rather than inflict death upon the sinner. I say thank you, Jesus. You didn't have to do it, but you did. Where would we be without him? Like Tasha Cobb say, where would I be without you? Where would I be without you? You turned my life around. And I feel the same way. I thirst was on the most obvious level a request for something to drink. In response to the soldiers, they gave him sour wine. Jesus didn't do a lot of talking while he was on the cross. It was as if he felt like he was all alone. He was enduring extraordinary pain, an extreme thirst, and a major struggle. How many of you are quiet when you're going through something? Raise your hand. Me too. I also am quiet when I am going through something. But it's a time to be quiet and it's a time to speak up. Is there anyone here that feels like you're alone when you're going through things? Well, know that you are not. Know that if when you go through things, that Jesus is with you. That wonderful name, the merciful name, that sweetest name that I know. That powerful name. You just call on that name and he'll help you. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue will give praise to God. Now that's something to shout about. The last seven words of Christ from the cross provide a window into Jesus' soul, a way to understand through his own last words as he was dying on the cross. By Jesus suffering the many hardships, he is able to understand us and sustain us. He is also able to comfort us in our moments of suffering. And this is found in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18, and chapter 4, verses 15 and 16. The Gospel of John first refers to the thirst when Jesus meets the Samaritan woman at the well. After first asking for a drink, he answered the woman, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of this water that I will give them will never thirst. The water that I will give them will become a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." And this is found in John chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. Jesus also thirsts in a spiritual sense, which was his thirst for the love of his Father, who had left him unaided during his dreadful hour when he had to fulfill his mission. He also thirsts for the love and salvation for his people, the human race. As I reflect on Jesus' statement, I thirst, I keep thinking of my own thirst. I thirst for him. My soul yearns for him. Yearns for the living water that Jesus supplies. Jesus rejoiced in the fact that he suffered physical thirst on the cross so much more so that my thirst for the water of life may be quenched in yours too. The water of life, which is the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit resides in every believer. It leads, guides, and helps us to do the will that God wants us to do. I thank you for your time.
My name is Pamela White. My church is Memorial Drive Church of Christ. My pastor is Terry Bush, no first name. My life verse is Romans 8:2. For the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. My fivefold calling is a prophet, evangelist, and a teacher. I flow in the fruit of the spirit of the highest in faith, gentleness, and love. Let us pray. Father God, I thank you for the opportunity to bring us into your house on one accord, Father, making us become one that your spirit may dwell upon each and every one of us. For you know what each and every one of us needs, Father God. And we thank you that we are in a place where we can provide it, our faith to you, to where, Father God, you can look down on us and bless us. In the mighty name of Jesus. My verse is John 19:30. It is finished. I'm speaking on the last words of Jesus, it is finished. Jesus' last word meant that his suffering was over and the whole work his Father had given him to do was to preach the gospel, work miracles, obtain eternal salvation for his people was done, accomplished, fulfilled. The debt of sin was paid. Finished means having completed or ended an action or activity, not requiring no more work. Eternally done or eternally completed. The redemption plan to bring us back to the Father was fulfilled and completed. It is finished. Oops, I missed a page. There it goes. I'm sorry. Finished. No more work required. We as a church now only have to accept and believe in our Lord Jesus Christ. We don't have to suffer or pay for our debts. He has already done it. It has already been paid in full. We now can tell the enemy, listen, I'm done letting you control my mind, my body, my health, and my home, my marriage. I will not accept your lies, your deceit over my house, my family, my faith, or my church. Today it stops. It is finished. I can live in the law of the spirit of life. Romans 8:2. For the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. The law of Christ. The law of life includes love, joy, peace, happiness, prosperity, abundance, health, contentment, and blessing all the days of our lives. These provisions was made for us as children of Christ. It is law. It is spiritual law. We must enforce these laws in our lives. His word is true and unchanging. We can be nothing but blessed. Enforce the law, the spiritual law, walk in blessing. Tell any and everything that comes against you in any form that is not of God, it is finished. In my closing, God has given out all tools we need to fulfill our spiritual walk. He has blessed us with the most, the breastplate, the armor of God, breastplate of righteousness, life, hope, and truth. So when the enemy throws them darts at you in any form,
They will not pierce your heart or your life. But trust me without a doubt, when you send them back with the word of God, it will pierce the enemy. And it will make him back up. It will make him bow down and make him say to himself, it is finished here. So for Jesus has overcome this world and all that it holds. Melody Humphrey, and a member of the Church of the Gospel of Jesus Christ. But my pastor is Dr. Alfred K. Humphrey. And I'm co-pastor. My life verse, it was so many to choose from. Psalms 51 and 10, that's how I'm feeling today. Created me a clean heart,
now,
oh God,
now.
And renew a right spirit within me. Then of course I had Deuteronomy 28, but I won't go there. I did that Wednesday night, or Tuesday night. My 5-4 calling, general, administrative, and a teacher. My fruit of the spirit, peace, love, and long suffering. My spiritual gifts, administration, and showing mercy. Let us pray. Lord, I just thank you again for this opportunity to be in your service one more time, God. I thank you for waking us all up this morning, having the activities of our limbs and having the right mind. Again, may the words go out. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing, be acceptable to you, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. My scripture for this evening, Father, I put my life in your hands. That's Luke 23:46. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said this, he gave up the ghost. Jesus called out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. That's King James Version. I have several different versions here because one just wouldn't do me.
All right, yeah.
And the reason I'm laughing, because God, I'm in your service on a Friday night.
Amen. Come on now. All right.
Good place to be.
All right, Lord.
And said, when Jesus spoke these words, he breathed his last breath. From Psalms 31 and 5, Jesus shouted, Father, I put my hands into your hands. Do you put your hands into God's hands?
All right. Amen.
Come on.
He spoke in a loud voice so that the people may know what he was about to do. He could have been silent, like some of you all pray silently. Or he could have just said it in his head. Sometimes we say things in our mind. But he let it be known. Why did Jesus speak in such a loud voice? So everyone would know. It would be no shadow, doubt, guessing, whatever. They were going to know. And that's the way our life with Christ has to be. Everybody got to know. We're living in end times. We got to know. At the grocery store, everybody got to know who Jesus is. When you go to class meeting, everybody got to know. They come by you, you're going to be talking about Jesus. Because the time is at hand. Do you think I have to come to abolish the law? I came to fulfill the law. The last 7 words of the cross are for Jesus, is saying, it is completed. My assignment has been completed. At the end of your life, what will your assignment be? Will you say, I completed the course? I'm still out there waiting. He said, the Father. See, he's going back to the Father, part of the Trinity.
Yes.
See, he came from on high. He came to this earth.
Yes.
Not for himself, but for us.
Yes.
He came to save us. He came to heal us. He came to deliver us.
Yes.
Oh, I thank you, God.
Yes.
You did something for me that I couldn't do for myself. If I had 10,000, glory! See, I prayed this evening on a Friday evening when I came over here. But as I sit here, I begin, and you all begin to minister to me. Everyone different had their own style. And that's the way God made us. We all were something different. And as the lady spoke about the 12, the jewels, we're all jewels. God is so awesome.
Oh, yes.
And as they minister to us in music, and the tears begin to flow, I always say, I don't have no more tears. I don't find my last tear. But again, the tears began to flow, and I had to find me some clinics because I know what God has done for me. Again, I thank you now. Last seven phrases of Jesus, completion. Ask yourself, will you give it to your Father? Will you give it up to your Father? Will you commit, will you commend your life to your Father? Again, he gave it up. If he can give it up, you can give it up. Lord, I just want to thank you as we pray. Lord, I just thank you again for sending your Son to die for us. He created us in his own image. Again, God, I thank you for all you do. I thank you for your hedge of protection about us and our loved ones. Again, it's about letting the words of God go out so that we can say, what can we do to be saved? Again, we need to introduce everybody we see to Jesus. In Jesus' mighty, powerful name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. I did not pull together a panelist for our students, but I will ask Pastor Humphrey, who has been a panelist for a number of years, if he would just gather his thoughts and just give us a general. He looked at his wife like, did you tell him to say that question? If you just give us some short words if you feel led. If you don't feel led, we're still good. But before he comes, I want to put the students to work. And I want to know if there's anyone tonight that need to be saved.
Glory.
Amen. You need to ask Jesus to come inside of your heart. I want to ask the students to line up this pew. And I believe they are prepared to pray for you. If there's anyone in the house that needs healing, thank you, Jesus. Anyone need to recommit to the Lord? Anyone need a deliverance? We believe that the anointing resides upon these ladies. And they can pray. And the burden will be removed and the yoke destroyed. And you won't have to leave this place the same way you came. Glory to God. If there's anyone that want prayer tonight, we are here to pray for you. Everyone standing just for a minute. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of God. If you'll just step out boldly. Amen. One of these ladies will go forth. Thank you, Jesus. All the saints are praying. Glory to your name, Jesus. Glory to your name, Jesus. Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Jesus. Nothing is too difficult for you. Hallelujah. Nothing is too hard for you, Jesus. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Come on, step out if you want prayer. There's nothing too difficult. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Come on, we're here to pray for you. There's nothing too hard for the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory. Thank you, Jesus. Some of you need a financial breakthrough. Come on. Dear God, every bank in Tulsa is closed, but the bank of heaven is open. Glory. He's here to open the windows of heaven for you. Thank you, God.
spirit of bondage will be broken tonight. We touch and agree. Come on, saints. If you need prayer, I wouldn't be standing in that pew. I wouldn't listen to any demon that tells me I don't need to go down there. Not my brother, not my mother, not my father, not my cousin, not my niece, not my uncle, not my auntie, but it's me right now, Lord. I'm standing in the need of prayer. I need a prayer warrior to touch and agree. My God, with me right now, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Come on, church. She's moving. Every burden be destroyed. Every yoke be broken. Come on, saints. Come on down for prayer. We're here. We're here. Oh, yeah, God. Thank you, Jesus. The deliverer is in the house. Glory to God. Whatever you need, we've already decreed and declared it, that God has it for you. It's yours, glory. Hallelujah. Children. But tonight, tonight, God, you have supplied. You are my provider, Jehovah Jireh. And while I'm here, I'm going to give it all. Come on, church. You ought to praise him.
Shall not return unto him void, but shall accomplish for the very thing wherever he sent it. I want to encourage the teachers and the preachers and those that are supporting this ministry to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain. God bless you, amen.
Thank you, Pastor. Amen.
I forgot. Everybody get 100.
Amen. I agree. You deserve 100. Amen. 99 and a half. You just won't do. Amen. Well, we're so glad tonight you can join us again, Harvest Time Prayer Ministry, on May 4th. We will be celebrating the National Day of Prayer here. That's a Thursday night at 7 o'clock p.m. We are anticipating some of our community leaders to be here, Senator Kevin Matthews, State Representative Regina Goodwin, and the list goes on. They will be sharing with us things that's going on in our community that we may not be aware of. But once they give it to us, we will go into direct prayer for those things. The Honorable Sharon K. Holmes will also be in attendance, and we're looking for some from the mayor's office. We're looking for some from the school board and some from city council to come and just
share with us even their own personal issues that they may be needing prayer about. How many know it's praying time? We are releasing bombs and different things are going on. Amen. And so we don't know if retaliation will come, but we know we'll be ready because we'll be prepared by prayer. Amen. And living a sanctified life. How many can say amen?
Amen.
With no further ado, with everyone standing, we want to thank Sister Precious for leading us in worship tonight. Sister Tamora McHenry probably had to leave, but we're thankful for her. We're thankful for Minister Joshua Palmer.
Amen.
And this brother here on the drums, I don't know him, but thank you for coming and filling in. You did an awesome job tonight. Well, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord bless your children and your children's children. We bind and forbid every plot, every trick, every scheme of the enemy, every backlash, every form of retaliation. We paralyze it and render it harmless and ineffective in your life. And we release the blessings of the Lord that make you rich and add no sorrow. We release good success from the Lord over your life. We speak blessings upon blessings upon blessings over you. Touch yourself and say, I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
God bless you. Thank you for all those who came out tonight. We had an excellent attendance for Friday night, and there were other Friday night services, but I'm so thankful. We want to remind you that the fourth Saturday of every month, and the fourth Saturday coming up is April 22nd from 8 a.m. until noon. We have 4 hours of prayer power. We have prayer, we have worship, and we get a word from the Lord. You need to come. We're studying about the demonic. And some of us need that teaching. Because the devil is in and out and we don't even recognize him. He's crossing his leg and taking a seat and we're patting him on his back. But we want to expose the demonic. So if you come on the fourth Saturday, April 22nd, right here at 8 a.m. in this sanctuary, you will not regret those 4 hours of your life. God bless you.